Day Street Books and Harper Audio present The 99% Invisible City, a field guide to the hidden world of everyday design by Roman Mars and Kurt Kohlstedt. Read by Roman Mars. In addition to the audiobook, this recording includes a bonus Q&A and an episode of the 99% Invisible podcast at the end of the program.
For all you plaque readers and curious urbanists. Introduction. The world is full of amazing things. Walk around any major city and you will find soaring skyscrapers that inspire awe, bridges that are marvels of engineering, and lush parks that provide respite from the concrete landscape. There are travel guides for all of that. This, however, is a guide to the overlooked and ordinary, the boring stuff. The truth is that the mundane objects we pass by without noticing or trip over without thinking can represent as much genius and innovation as the tallest building, the longest bridge, or the most manicured park. So much of the conversation about design centers on beauty, but the more fascinating stories of the built world are about problem solving, historical constraints, and human drama. This has always been the worldview of the 99% Invisible podcast. Since 2010, we have told stories about all the thought that goes into things most people don't think about. Our name references the everyday objects that are invisible because of their everydayness, but it also refers to the invisible parts of things that you do notice. In the case of something like the Chrysler Building, the aesthetics and architecture of the massive Art Deco tower are only 1% of the story. It's our mission to tell you about the hidden parts of the story, the speed of its construction, the building's place in the great Manhattan skyscraper race, the iconoclastic architect who designed it, and his daring secret strategy to beat out the competition at the last possible moment. As beautiful as the Chrysler Building is, the 99% invisible part is the best part. In the print book, unlike the podcast, we get the opportunity to show you pretty images, illustrated by Patrick Vail, that help tell the hidden history and development of these designs. That said, this guide is not meant to be an encyclopedia that provides a few rote paragraphs about the inventor or origin story of each object. You have Wikipedia for that. This is about breaking down the cityscape into its more fascinating subparts. Rather than tell you about the first traffic light, we'd rather tell you about the most interesting traffic light in the world, the one in Syracuse, New York, that has the green light above the red light as a display of Irish pride. Instead of recounting the construction of the jaw-dropping Brooklyn Bridge, we introduce you to the aesthetically mundane can opener bridge of Durham, North Carolina, which has an uncanny history of shearing off the tops of tall trucks trying to pass underneath. The Brooklyn Bridge represents an incredible advancement in engineering, but Durham's Norfolk Southern Gregson Street overpass illustrates the perils of sclerotic modern transit bureaucracy, something citizens bang their heads against every day. Like the best-intentioned urban planners, we have laid out a path for you as we walk together through this inevitably incomplete guide to the city. We take you through the things you never noticed, as well as the things you always notice but might not understand. From massive top-down municipal infrastructure made by trained planners at their desks to bottom-up citizen interventions created by urban activists. However, there's no reason why you can't pick and choose the path through this book that suits your own journey. Create a personal desire path, a favorite subject in the 99% Invisible universe. Desire paths emerge when people trample on the grass to cut a route to a place they want to go when urban planners have failed to provide a designated paved walkway. These spontaneous trails are shaped by pedestrians who are effectively voting with their feet. Most of the desire paths you encounter in a city trace the shortest distance between two points, often to cut corners. But many others are there just because people want to take a path less traveled. Once a desire path is created, it frequently becomes self-reinforcing. Others begin following these newly formed routes, which increases their visibility and perpetuates their usage. So as you make your way through your own city, or one you're visiting, keep this audiobook with you, find a story, and just listen. If you are in a city, you will probably find some analog to the thing we're talking about, even if the specific example being discussed is in London or Osaka or beautiful downtown Oakland, California. This is your guide to decoding the built world in whatever city you find yourself. Once you learn about all the designs in this book, you will look at the world in a radically different way. You will exult in curb cuts, shake your fist at bench armrests, and tell the person walking next to you that the orange spray-painted markings on the street mean there are telecommunication lines just below the surface. You are about to see stories everywhere, you beautiful nerd. Chapter 1. Inconspicuous. There is a hidden world of design all around you if you look closely enough, but the cacophony of visual noise in our cities can make it hard to notice key details. There are street markings that protect you from being blown to bits, tiny safes affixed to building exteriors that can help save occupants in a fire, and ornamental flourishes that may seem like mere decoration, but actually work to hold entire brick buildings together. Amid all of this, there are also myriad incremental odds and ends that simply accumulate through people forever reshaping a city to fit their needs. Decoding these more subtle aspects of the cityscape can also help you gain insight into the people who make cities what they are, most of whom are just trying to live their lives, but some of whom are actively trying to save yours. Ubiquitous. Once you start to see them, you'll never understand how you hadn't noticed them before. On any given city street, there are design details scattered everywhere that are meant to establish boundaries or protect you on an everyday basis and in cases of emergency. Even obscure notations created and used by specialists contain layers of information written onto the built world that can be read by anyone who knows how to decipher them. Official graffiti. Utility codes. Careless or uninformed digging around cables and pipes can cause everything from major utility outages to gas leaks. Or, as in the case of a 1976 incident in California, a gigantic explosion that leveled half a city block. One fateful day in June of that year, workers were excavating a stretch of Venice Boulevard in Los Angeles when someone accidentally cut into a hidden petroleum pipeline. The pipe ruptured and pressurized gas ignited into a fireball that engulfed passing cars and adjacent businesses. More than 24 people were killed or injured as a result of this error. This wasn't the first or last tragedy of its kind, but the enormity of this particular disaster helped catalyze the codification of critical color-coded utility markings that are so omnipresent today. If you are in a U.S. city, look down, and you will see colorful official street graffiti everywhere. These markings are a guide to the networks of pipes, wires, and tubes crisscrossing below you. The Los Angeles explosion spurred the creation of Dig Alert, a nonprofit designed to help prevent future such tragedies in Southern California. Today, excavators in the region are required to mark out the work areas with white paint, chalk, or flags and reach out to Dig Alert. The organization then identifies and contacts companies with utilities running through the site, so their technicians can go out and mark off potential hazards. Locators sent out by these companies can employ cable avoidance tools to establish or confirm the position and depths of things below the surface. Ground-penetrating radar and devices to detect metals or magnetic fields help pinpoint concrete pipes, plastic tubes, and metal cables. Potential subsurface hazards are then highlighted using standardized color-coded markings. Over the decades, similar services to Dig Alert have formed across the United States. To simplify things, the FCC designated 811 as the federal phone number in 2005 to connect excavators with these organizations. In general, anyone excavating on public property is required to contact a regional alert organization before proceeding, though private property owners are encouraged to reach out as well. According to a recent DIRT, that's Damage Information Reporting Tool, report, tens of thousands of accidents could be avoided each year if everyone called when planning to dig, drill, blast, or trench. For clarity and consistency, U.S. utility companies rely on uniform color codes developed by the American Public Works Association when mapping out subterranean utilities on surfaces above. On city streets today, you can see the spectrum of safety colors that have been formalized and revised over the decades by the American National Standards Institute. Red signifies electric power lines, cables, and conduit. Orange is for telecommunications, alarm, and signal lines. Yellow for gaseous or combustible materials, including natural gas, oil, petroleum, and steam. Green for sewers and drain lines. Blue for potable water. Purple for reclaimed water irrigation or slurry lines. Pink for temporary markings, unidentified facilities, and known unknowns. And white for proposed excavation areas, limits, or routes. While the use of different colors provides general information about what's below, notations including lines, arrows, and numbers are also needed to keep track of details about locations, widths, and depths of specific hazards. Here, too, standards are helpful, and there are organizations dedicated to helping coordinate and disseminate these. Among other functions, the nonprofit Common Ground Alliance maintains an exhaustive best practices guide for underground safety and damage prevention. Documents like this one also provide useful explanations and diagrams for curious urbanists looking to decode street markings. Some enthusiasts take things a step further and create more expansive guides. Artist Ingrid Burrington's book, Networks of New York, contains more than 100 pages on just one color category of utility in one city, the orange that designates network infrastructure in the Big Apple. Her volume dives deeply into the history of competing telecoms, but it also lays out practical examples for identification, like an arrow flanked by the letters F and O, which together indicate the path of a fiber optic line directly below a stretch of pavement. In the wild, such markings are sometimes accompanied by numbers indicating depths, names identifying associated utility companies, and abbreviations referring to the types of materials in play, such as PLA for plastic pipes. Different countries have their own national, regional, and local conventions too, which can be more or less official. In a BBC News article, journalist Lawrence Cawley scratches the surface of London's underground utilities with some local examples, including ones that illustrate how intuitive certain codes can be. A number next to a D often indicates depth, for instance. For electrical lines, HV means high voltage, LV denotes low voltage, and SL stands for streetlights. For gas lines, HP refers to high pressure, MP to medium pressure, and LP to low pressure. Some markings are harder to understand at first glance, like a looping infinity symbol used to indicate the beginning or end of a proposed project area, a counterintuitive use of a character normally applied to things without beginnings or ends. Biodegradable paints are typically employed to create the various colored letters and symbols sprayed by specialists onto the streets and sidewalks of our cities. These odd hieroglyphics are then either erased in the course of excavations or simply left to fade over time, slowly making room for newer, more vibrant squiggles when the next project rolls around. While they last, though, such markings provide essential information to diggers, as well as ephemeral windows for the rest of us, into the complex systems running right beneath our feet. Initialed impressions. Sidewalk markings. As the country's original capital and the backdrop of many key moments of American history, the city of Philadelphia is lousy with important era-defining monuments and plaques, whose grandeur can make subtler and less dramatic markers easy to miss. Amid the many statues standing in squares and tablets affixed to buildings are a series of enigmatic plaques embedded in sidewalks. The etched or embossed messages on these metal plaques read like abstract spatial koans, or urban poems advising pedestrians that, quote, space within building lines not dedicated, or, quote, property behind this plaque not dedicated. In property law, dedicating means giving over to another party, the public, for example. The wording on these plaques varies, but the basic message of these so-called easement markers is the same. You pedestrians are welcome to walk here for now, but just a heads up, this is actually private property. To define such areas, long, thin, rectangular plaques are often arrayed to form a dash demarcation line along the boundary of the property, while right-angled variations are used to define the corners. In a 2016 Plan Philly article, reporter Jim Saxa explains that, quote, the plaques are used when the property lines don't align with the building's physical dimensions or the dimensions of any sort of fencing, landscaping, or other improvements that would clearly mark a boundary between the public right-of-way and private property, end quote. In other words, a passerby might assume a property line ends at a fence or a hedge or the edge of a building when the actual property line might run through a sidewalk instead. Easement laws can give people limited rights to cross other people's land, but can also allow for different forms of adverse possession. As Saxa explains the concept, if someone uses a piece of property to, quote, blatantly, consistently, and exclusively for a long, statutorily set amount of time, 21 years in Pennsylvania, then they own it, end quote. In the case of these prescriptive easements in Philadelphia, if private owners fail to explicitly mark out their territory, someone could eventually argue that they have forfeited ownership. That's why you'll see these markers embedded in sidewalks both there and in other cities. The plaques ensure that the public knows that this particular patch of sidewalk belongs to the property owner even if they allow the public to walk on it, for now. Such plaques only scratch the proverbial surface of the sidewalk etchings that comprise a cityscape. There are, of course, the ubiquitous informal markings made less than legally by ordinary citizens, like so-and-so plus so-and-so with a heart around it scratched into drying concrete sidewalks. But there are formal marks too, and not just for easements. Among the semi-permanent declarations of love, you'll find elegant signatures in many cities that were left by the construction companies that laid the sidewalk. In California's Bay Area, sidewalks in cities like Oakland feature stamps or plaques dating back to the early 1900s, when concrete began to take off as a cheap and robust alternative to brick or board walkways. Many sidewalk stamps that remain date back to the 1920s through the post-war era of rapid urban expansion. Some are wrapped with decorative borders and include construction dates, addresses, phone numbers, and even union numbers. A curious individual could write down the stamped union number, go to the union office, and look up the name of the individual who smoothed out that patch of concrete 50 years before. In places like Chicago, these markers are ubiquitous and detailed because they are required to be under municipal law. Quote, before the top or finishing of concrete walks is set, the contractor or person building the walk shall place in such walk in front of each lot or parcel of property a stamp or plate given plainly the name and address of the contractor or person building the walk and the year in which the work was done, end quote. In turn, these markings end up becoming physical archives of urban development, telling the history of cities and city building businesses, and outlining tales of neighborhood construction and expansion. In the sidewalks of Berkeley, California, there are markings representing the evolution of a family business over decades. A Paul Schnorr stamp might show a date of 1908, while over in a newer neighborhood, you'll find a Schnorr & Son stamp, presumably a rebranding that took place when the next generation began working for their dad. If you encounter an even more recent construction project, you can actually find a Schnorr Brothers mark that recalls the era after dad retired and the boys took over. In some cases, concrete installers have effectively turned sidewalks into signage too, naming streets at intersections, lending them additional wayfinding functions. This hasn't always gone well for cities, though. Back in 1909, an article in the Calgary Herald titled Calgary Can't Spell lamented prominent misspellings like Lincoln and Secound Avenue etched in the sidewalks. The piece pressed for the prevention of, quote, any further occurrences of the disgraceful spelling with which the names of our streets and avenues are unfadingly imprinted in the walks of stone, end quote, admonishing that, quote, workmanship such as this might be tolerated in ramshackle frontier towns, but cannot be in Calgary, end quote. In response, municipal workers were instructed to tear out the offending slabs and thus spare the proud Albertan city further embarrassment. In San Diego and other cities, old sidewalk stamps, at least the ones that are spelled right, are actively protected. Construction workers are supposed to work around them whenever possible when tearing up and replacing sidewalks, so these small pieces of urban history can be preserved. These days, many cities no longer require markers on new sections of sidewalk. Some bureaucratic killjoys even mandate that contractors get a permit to sign their work, and they significantly limit the size of signature stamps. After all, these represent free and durable advertising that can last for decades or longer. But more important for us, sidewalk markings tell a rich story about who made our built environment, down to the individual worker who got down on his knees and made a piece of land smooth and walkable for generations of people.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.